welcome to New Salem's virtual worship experience and 2021 Revival Kickoff. Please keep watching to hear important information and updates.
Good morning, New Salem. How are you? Oh, by the way, good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm fine.
I'm excellent.
Thank
good.
You.
I'm
good
excellent.
To see
Thank you. Thank you for coming. We are here this morning because this is starting revival. Yes, revival. Is there anything you want to say?
You know, last year we weren't able to have revival.
I had revival.
The church wasn't able to have revival.
I had revival. I traveled around the country to other churches. I went to revival.
You traveled around the country to other churches?
Yeah, virtually.
Virtually, okay.
Yes, virtually.
Yeah, because I was like, I thought that was you that I was with for a whole year. Maybe it wasn't, but in terms of that.
Yes, but I did have revival.
Okay.
So, but I didn't have New Salem's revival.
Thank you.
We miss you, New Salem. Well, Pastor miss you. I miss you, New Salem.
Truly, we do miss the New Salem family. We're looking forward to our 2021 revival with Dr. Willie and Francois, who was with us 2 years ago. Excited for it. It will be virtual. We've never done it this way before. But we're looking forward to doing it this way this time and see how it comes out. Invite your friends and family. Just imagine, you could have revival all over the country with all of your friends and families. Invite them to come in. Be prayerful for Reverend Francois now as we get ready to be revived in 2021 through our virtual platforms.
Hello, I'm Reverend Eddie Roberts, Director of Membership at the New Salem Baptist Church. My passion as an associate minister here at New Salem Baptist Church is really to help people lead a connected life. And what I mean by a connected life is that healthy people that understand who Christ is and what he's calling them to do equals healthy families, which equals a healthy church. What we like to do here at New Salem is that when you become a member, we have a fantastic approach to getting you ingrained in who we are as New Salem, to having you understand and discover what are the gifts and talents that God has given you, so that knowing that he has called you to serve in one of the ministries in which we have. Well, there is one thing that I want you to remember. Not only do we want you to lead a connected life, connected to Christ, connected to the family of New Salem, but also connected to the community, but we want to make sure that you and your family are healthy. But the last and most important thing, that even though we're a large but small church, I want you to understand that there is a place and a space for you and your family here at New Salem, and it's my humble pleasure to serve you.
Good morning, New Salem. I'm Reverend Landon Adams, Director for the Maturity Department here in New Salem. Our scripture this morning comes from the book of John, chapter 15, verses 1 through 4, where we find these words of Jesus. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he purges, prunes, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except that it abide in the vine, no more can you, except that you abide in me. The the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, we are thankful this morning as we come to another Sunday, another start and dawn of a week, but to this annual observance of revival. We are thankful to still be connected to you, the true vine, where we can bear fruit, much fruit, in season and out of season. This past year has been one where we did not expect to have to bear certain fruit, to endure certain seasons or weather, but because we have abided and remained in you, you have been faithful to abide and remain in us. We come now in this service and in this time of revival that you would continue to revive us again, that you would encourage our hearts, renew our minds, give joy to our spirits, that you would be pleased with us, that we would know you better, and that we as a community would continue to live a connected life. We give you thanks and praise for this day, for this worship, for this word, and for this life you have given us together. It's in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. God is good. He's good right now. His goodness and his mercy have been following us all the days of our lives. My go-to scripture has become, I would have fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. God, we just honor you today, and we declare that we just want to praise you. Not just today, not just tomorrow, but forever, even forevermore. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, join in with us, people of God, as we declare this praise unto our God. Glory, glory, hallelujah, hallelujah. Just want to praise you.
Just want to praise you.
Forever.
Forever.
And ever.
And ever.
Hallelujah.
And ever.
Blessings and glory,
blessings
and honor,
they belong to you.
Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just want to praise you, not just today, but forever and ever. Oh yes, I do. All that you have done, all that you've done for me. Blessings and glory, all the honor that belong to you. Oh yes, they do. Thank you,
Jesus,
for blessing me. Your praise shall be in my mouth continuously. For all that you've done, all that you've done for me. Blessings and glory, they all belong to you. Yes, they do.
They all belong to you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus,
for blessing.
Just wanna pray.
I just wanna pray. you for your blessings. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy, oh God. Thank you for your faithfulness, oh God. Thank you for your protection, oh God. Thank you for your provision, oh God. Hallelujah. 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 You've been so good to us, and we give you praise, honor, and glory. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, New Salem. God is great and he's greatly to be praised. And I'm so excited to know that we are not alone in this walk. We might have felt like we've been alone along the way, but we are not alone. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Here we go. The Lord is our shepherd.
Lord is my shepherd.
He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Thank you, Lord. Defender behind me.
Defender behind me.
Yes, God. I won't fear.
I won't fear.
Come on, let's worship God together. Filled with anointing.
Filled with anointing.
Yes, God. My cup is overflowing.
My cup's overflowing.
Yes, God. No weapon can harm me.
No weapon can harm me.
Thank you, Lord God. I won't fear.
I won't fear.
Say hallelujah. Guides me.
He always guides me.
Through mountains and valleys.
Through mountains and valleys.
His joy is refreshing.
His joy is refreshing.
He restores my soul.
Restores my
mercy and goodness.
Mercy and goodness.
Thank you, Lord. Give me assurance.
Give me assurance.
That we'll see his glory.
That I'll see his glory.
Face to face.
Face to face.
One more time for Jesus. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I am not alone.
I am not alone.
Wherever you are, wherever you might have been, he says this to you. He's your comfort. Goes like this. Listen. Say your spirit.
Your spirit lives within me.
So I walk in your peace.
So I will walk in your peace. Your spirit
lives within
my victory.
My victory.
Say
Your spirit lives within
so
me.
I'll walk in your
so
peace.
I will walk in your peace.
Say
Your spirit lives within
say
me.
My victory.
Remember that God is your comfort. He promises that he will never leave you. He will never forsake you or never alone. No matter what the enemy has said to you, no matter what the enemy has shown you, God is here to remind you that you are never alone. You never walk alone. He is always beside you. He has never left you. He's always comforting you. So remember that today. Remember as you walk through life that God has never left you. In fact, he's been there before the beginnings of the earth. He knows you by name. He sustains your spirit. He reminds you that he loves you, and he will never, ever turn his back on you. If there's a believer in this place and under the sound of my voice, put your hands together and begin to worship the Lord for never leaving you and never forsaking you. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Thank you, God.
Tempest comes when you say peace. The universe resounds your splendor with worthy praise. Almighty God, to you I am constrained. I'm bound. with love I can't contain. Oh, I know my duty, I know my purpose is to give you praise.
You are my destiny.
DNA.
exist to give you praise.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be made glad in it. What a joy it is to be back in the cyber sanctuary, to be back in the family of the New Salem Church. This is a gift for me to be able to share with you. I lamented not being with you last year, but I'm excited that God has worked it out, that God has even marshaled and commanded our creativity to make this revival season happen. And so I salute our great God, our ever-living, ever-loving, ever-present, ever-creative God, whose spirit has moved throughout these waves, has transferred across the screens already throughout this service. And then I thank God for your pastor. Dr. Troy is a significant gift to the kingdom of God. It is by his work, by his example, by his model, by his creativity, by his leadership that so many congregations across the world have been changed. And so I salute you, Dr. Troy, for allowing me to share today, and to the New Salem family, you hold a special place in my heart, and I thank God for this privilege to be back with you, even though we are in the cyber sanctuary. And we salute all of those who made these services, will make these services possible as we celebrate revival. And this morning, as we are in the middle of Women's History Month, I want to draw our attention to the book of Exodus, Exodus chapter 2. For this Women's History Month, as we start this revival season, I want to do what this month is designed to do, and that's to celebrate women. We know that women, black women, deserve our celebration 365 days a year, but it's this month that I appreciate the opportunity as a nation, as a world, as a church, to be able to turn aside and give some attention to the brilliance, creativity, power, wholeness, fullness of women. And so Exodus chapter 2, commencing at verse 7. Exodus chapter 2, commencing at verse 7. When you have it, will you put it in the chat? Say, I'm there, I'm there, I'm there. Exodus chapter 2, commencing at verse 7. Then Moses' sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called Moses' mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because she said, "I drew him out of the water." So the woman took the child and nursed him. When the child grew up, she brought him back to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. And she named him Moses because she said, "I drew him out of the water." For time is ours to share this morning. I want to think on the thought, if it wasn't for the women. If it wasn't for the women. The U.S. space program rigorously contributes to the air of pride that Americans tour around the global stage. We started really even as a young child in Texas. NASA was a big part of our upbringing. It was a part of the culture of what it meant to be Texan, a part of the culture of what it meant to be American. There was an air of pride connected to the space program, to NASA in this country. The mathematical precision and the aeronautical inventiveness, the U.S. clinched the coveted title as the first to the moon and the first to orbit the Earth. These storied experiences and spirited reputation frequently trigger thoughts about people like Neil Armstrong and John Glenn and Jim Lovell and Guion Bluford. But in the 1960s, when those astronauts decided that they were going to be a part of that history-making moment where Alan Shepard and Gus Grissom and John Glenn and others, they decided that it would be at that point that America would be the first to orbit the globe, to orbit the world, that it was in that moment that we only remembered the names of those men, Alan, Gus, and John, and whatever white men that were connected to them, that was a moment where the U.S. was catapulted to the top of the space race, and all of the accolades went to men like Alan Shepard and Gus Grissom and John Glenn and other men who were undoubtedly white. However, although all of the attention for America being catapulted to the front of the space race, although all of that attention went to those white men, behind the scenes, they were supported by hundreds of unheralded NASA workers, including human computers who did the calculations for their orbital trajectories. You all may remember this tale in the movie Hidden Figures. It's in Hidden Figures that we remove the white sexist veil that obscures the history, and we see that the real brains and the real clarity of this scientific feat was really connected to at least three black women. We even heard, as that movie gained greater celebrity, and Katherine Johnson, who was at the heart of this, she even said to herself that in that time, what really made NASA work were the computers that wore skirts, because it was these black women, it was women who were in the background making sure that there was mathematical precision, making sure that the engineering was sound. It was women behind the scenes, not the men who were flying the craft, but those that did the science behind the exploration, that actually cemented America's place in the space race. And you all will remember that riveting movie that it was, that for years during their tenure, although they were behind the brains behind the operations, these computers that wore skirts, we remember that those that were black, they were segregated in two ways. They were segregated because of their race, but they were also segregated because of their gender. And the more and more we think about this, that movie was really important, and the book that preceded it, because it reminds us that although the attention has been absorbed by these white men, it was really Katherine Johnson and Dorothy Vaughan and Mary Jackson that advanced the U.S. forward in a real sense. If it wasn't for Katherine Johnson's mathematical tight coordinates, all the astronauts would have died along the mission. If it wasn't for Dorothy Vaughan's underpaid supervision of the other women computers, Russia would have beaten us to orbiting the Earth first. If it wasn't for Mary Jackson's voluminous experiment in the wind tunnels, the spacecraft would not have been sound enough to withstand the conditions of space in the first place. If it wasn't for the women, America would not have been the kind of space race winner that it has become. And that is really how I'm thinking about Moses today, is because indictingly resonant with so many of us, we heap all of the praise of God's abolitionist campaign in Egypt on Moses. We laud the tongue-tied prophet for the holy pressure applied to Pharaoh and the Egyptian elite to set my people free and let my people go. We put all of the energy around Moses, and we say Moses is the one that emancipated the Hebrew masses after roughly 400 years of public policy that was cramming them into the bottom of the caste system. We draw inspiration from Moses turning the Nile into a flowing current of blood. We know the consequences of Moses summoning pestilence and death on this oppressive nation. Our theological imagination feeds on the dramatic construction of a dry pathway in the middle of the Red Sea. We throw all of the praise on Moses because Moses is the one who's at the center. We give all of the excitement about Moses receiving the Ten Commandments. We say Moses is the one that led the Israelites out of the empire into the wilderness. It was Moses that received the dictation of the law from God. It was Moses that stood in between God and the Israelites. We place an entire all of the praise and all of the emphasis for the Exodus at the feet of the man Moses. However, when you look at this text, this chapter in particular, you'll find out that no Exodus emerges without the women who make Moses possible. The midwives, Shiphrah and Puah, his mother Jochebed, his sister Miriam, and his wife Zipporah. These are hidden figures that actually make Moses possible. I'm talking about they are hidden figures in the Bible that really deserve the praise and really deserve the spotlight, because there is no Exodus if there is no Moses, and there is no Moses without Shiphrah and Puah, without Jochebed and Miriam, and without Zipporah, because these women keep Moses alive on four separate occasions when death is encroaching on him. If it wasn't for the women, the possibility for liberation would have foreclosed before it ever started. There would neither be Moses nor an Exodus without the women in Moses' life that made Moses possible. And I need to pause right there, and somebody ought to be able to look back over your own life and start to rifle through the story of your own journey and your own becoming. And you'll be honest that you would not be where you are today if it had not been for the engagement, the sacrifice, the presence, the patience, and the power of some women who held us when we couldn't hold ourselves. Somebody ought to say, if it wasn't for the women, I wouldn't be who I am today. If it wasn't for the women, I wouldn't know how strong God is. If it wasn't for the women, I wouldn't be who I am, and I wouldn't be able to do what I do. I know we want to celebrate Moses, but there is no Moses without Shiphrah and Puah. There is no Moses without his mother Jochebed. There is no Moses without his sister Miriam and his wife Zipporah. And there ought to be somebody right now that can look back over your life and thank God that the hands and wombs of women are doing the work of God that makes us who we are today. Did you hear what I just said? I borrowed that from Dr. Will Gaffney, that the hands and the wombs of women are doing the work of God. And in a time where black women are still treated as disposable and throwaways, there ought to be sometimes that black men ought to be all right with putting a spotlight on black women, because if you'll be honest, there is no us without them. There is no church without them. There is no community without them. I need somebody to shout, if it wasn't for the women. No, somebody ought to put that in the chat as you share this stream, and you ought to thank God for every woman that showed up for you when you couldn't show up for yourself. Thank God that Exodus starts off this way. Don't forget that Exodus has this kind of centrifugal force, that everything about the Jewish identity can find its way back to the Exodus. The Exodus has a theological category. It pulls us into what I call abolitionist spirituality. If your faith is not about freedom, it's really not about God. But that's what these women show us. These women show us when you're connected to God, when you've been created in the image of an ever-living, ever-loving, ever-present, ever-creative God, freedom ought to be on your lips and freedom ought to be in your life. That's what these women show us. These women in Moses' life show us that God is the chief abolitionist, and we will be free because we were created by a free God to experience freedom. Am I talking to myself? And I'm not just talking about political freedom, because there's some of us who need some exoduses out of some personal situations that have tied our hands and shackled our feet and muzzled our mouths. Am I talking to anybody out there that can say, no, I'm an abolitionist? I was created to tear down what already destroys and build up out of the creative imagination of a God that knows that freedom is real and justice is possible. I wish I had somebody anywhere that can say, I thank God for abolitionist spirituality. I thank God for faith in God that is intolerant to racism, poverty, Islamophobia, xenophobia, economic exploitation, sexism, heterosexism. I thank God for a kind of spirituality that can tell me, in spite of what I've known my whole life, another life is possible. In spite of what's been restraining me and destroying me and gnawing at my strength, when you have abolitionist faith, you're able to say, I know what is, but I also know what will be. At the heart of Jesus' faith is a political event. So for everybody that wants to say that politics don't belong in religion, I want to remind you that slavery was a political issue. It was a policy issue. And God had to use some women to keep Moses alive in order for God to have a religious disruption to a political crisis. When you have the love of God in you, you are able to say that God is going to liberate us through a political innovation that's rooted in divine disruption. Somebody ought to just shout, I am a divine disruption. I am an in-flesh revelation that God can do exceedingly. Woo, Jesus, abundantly, above all you can ask or think. Am I talking to myself? I need somebody watching us today that can say, when you look at me, you are looking at an in-flesh revelation that God is disrupting the status quo through me. Four times in his life, Moses could have stopped breathing and Moses could have ceased to exist. But God placed some women providentially in his path that pushed him into his fullest possibilities. I need somebody anywhere that can say, God, thank you for every woman that you've providentially placed in my path that pushed me to my possibilities. Here's the text. Never forget this, that the Bible's first act of civil disobedience and nonviolent resistance comes from these midwives. These midwives, they resist the edicts of an insecure, megalomaniacal Pharaoh. Pharaoh had decided that all the newborn Hebrew boys must die as they are born. And he demanded, he sent out an executive order, sort of like putting children in cages. He barked out an executive order to the midwife guild and tells them that anytime you see a boy being born in a Hebrew house, I need you to kill that baby. This is what's powerful, because these state-sponsored deaths, they do not erase the holy courage of these women. They do not erase the holy courage of black women. These heads of what Dr. Gaff Daphne calls the Israelite Midwifery Guild. They invest more devotion to the God of possibilities than the government of predation. I got to pause right there because I wake up in the morning and I know government is real, but I also know that the God of possibilities is bigger than the government of predation. You have governments that prey on us by trying to steal our health care, governments that prey on us by allowing police officers not to be held accountable, governments that prey on us by putting children in cages, governments that prey on us that try to tell women what they can do with their health care and their bodies. You have governments that prey on us that allow 2 million children to be lost in the educational system. You have governments that prey on us that build big prisons in order for them to build smaller schools. You have governments that prey on us that they deregulate the market so they can regulate the human body. But I thank God for midwives like Shifra and Pua. I thank God for people that say, I don't fear Pharaoh or his army. I don't fear Pharaoh or his weapons or chariots because my hands are the hands that God is getting ready to use. Anybody here thanking God for all the women that marched and all the women that voted and all the women that showed up and practiced some moral resistance to the insanity of the politics of death? Oh, but Moses is still alive, not simply because the midwives refused to kill the babies, but Moses is still alive because Jochebed, a daughter of Levi the patriarch, practiced nurturing creativity. After the scapegoating Pharaoh deployed his army to practice infanticide toward every newborn boy by drowning them in the Nile River. I like this because she was born in Egypt. She remembers when there was freedom and now she knows slavery. She remembered peacetime practices and now she sees genocidal policies. But Jochebed, I love this because she's the mother of the movement. She's the mother of liberation because she didn't just birth one leader, but she birthed all three leaders, Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Jochebed knew that there was something great about Moses, and she said, I'm not going to kill him, and I'm not going to let anybody else kill him. And for 3 months, she concealed him where nobody could find him. I thank God that he's alive because his mother was able to practice creative nurturing and conceal him in spite of what the world wanted to do to him. Anybody here grateful for the women that birthed us and also the women that contributed to our rebirths? I thank God that I wasn't just born one time, but I thank God for my mother who birthed me, but also thank God for every other woman that has rebirthed me. The power of a woman can give new life to anything. I wish I had somebody anywhere that can say, yeah, I thank God for my birth, but I also thank God for my rebirths. I thank God for every time somebody gives my dreams new life. I thank God for every person that breathes new life into my possibilities. I thank God for folk that see me in my mess, but say, no, there's something else in him. There's something else in her. Lord, thank you for my birth and my rebirth. God, I thank you for the Jochebeds that were adaptive and helped to keep me alive. I'm taking too long, but Moses is also alive because of his sister. The midwives are the reason why he was able to be born. They created the culture for that. His mother's the one that actually birthed him and hid him, but his sister is the one that had some follow through. Look at how the story reports is that Moses is drifting through the reeds on the Nile River, and the canon reflects that Miriam, a prophet in her own right, she followed the ark as it breached the royal boundaries, and the Egyptian princess orders the assistants to retrieve the Hebrew boy. And look what happens. Miriam, she practiced an unyielding pursuit of following that basket, and she negotiates with the princess, and so much so that that Moses' mother gets to raise her own son and get paid to do it. That sounds like reparations to me. I wish somebody would thank God that Jochebed not only got to raise her son, but she got to raise her son, get paid to raise her son, and do it in the middle of a place that was trying to kill him. And that's because his sister had some follow through. I thank God for women who follow through even when we're at our most risky state. Am I talking to anybody that can thank God for folk who stayed when your future was uncertain? Can you thank God for folk who showed up when you didn't know if you were going to outlive what you couldn't fix? I got to go, but there are two other women I want to talk about, and that's the subversive compassion of that princess. She knows the policy. She knows the Hebrew boys are supposed to die. She knows that there's a culture that overcriminalizes these boys that were born into slavery, but she raises him as her own under the nose of the very man who wanted him dead in the first place. Lord, deliver me from people who won't quit pro quo relationships. There's some years I don't have anything to give. There's some weeks I don't have anything to give. There's some days I don't feel like talking. There's some years I just don't have it in me. But is there anybody that can thank God for some folk that will keep you when you don't have anything to give? Folk that will keep you when it doesn't automatically benefit them. I got one more woman that kept Moses alive, and that was his wife, Zipporah, the Cushite. She black. She blackity black. And Zipporah, I love this, because when they were on their route to Egypt and Moses almost lost his life, remember, Moses was a fugitive. He was on the most wanted list for a capital crime of murder. That's why he had to leave Egypt in the first place. And in that cryptic scene, for some reason, the words on the page say that God wants to kill Moses during that overnight pit stop as he was preparing to set his people free. But look at what happens, that God wants to kill him. Death is imminent, but Zipporah, his wife, she wakes up, grabs a rock, and circumcises her son, and keeps her husband alive. Did y'all hear what I just said? She wakes up, grabs the rock, circumcises her son, and keeps her husband alive. Tradition says that women can't perform circumcision. Tradition says that you have to get a circumcision during the day, but she did it in spite of what the culture said, and she did it at the wrong time. I need somebody that can thank God for every woman who showed up even when folks said it's the wrong time, when people thought it was too late, but they sacrificed anyway. The moral resistance of the midwives, that keeps Moses alive. The nurturing creativity of his mother, that keeps Moses alive. The subversive compassion of that Egyptian princess, that keeps Moses alive. The unyielding pursuit of his older sister, that keeps Moses alive. The radical sacrifice of his wife, that keeps Moses alive. And somebody will look back over your life and start to thank God for where the women showed up and saved your life and saved your dream and saved your marriage and saved your hope. I thank God for the generative courage, the productive sacrifice, the ageless excellence, the unimpeachable dignity, the uninterrupted joy, the unqualified love of death-resistant women. Women that can say, you will not die.
but you shall live. There is no conversation on the backside of the mountain through a burning bush without Shiphrah and Puah. There is no let my people go without Jochebed seeing something in her baby's face. There's no reception of the Ten Commandments without Miriam showing up and negotiating. There's no parting of the Red Sea without Zipporah making some sacrifices. If it wasn't for Harriet Tubman, the Underground Railroad would have stalled on its tracks. If it wasn't for Nanny Helen Burroughs, there would be a greater dearth for teen K through 12 education for black folk in America. If it wasn't for Mary McLeod Bethune, HBCUs would all be dead. If it wasn't for Jerina Lee, women wouldn't be preaching boldly in every pulpit. If it wasn't for Ida B. Wells, black bodies would still be hanging from southern trees like strange fruit. If it wasn't for Fannie Lou Hamer, the Democratic Party would still be all segregationists. If it wasn't for Rosa Parks and Claudette Copeland, Martin Luther King Jr. Would just be another country preacher. If it wasn't for if it wasn't for Shirley Chisholm, Jesse Jackson couldn't have run, and Obama couldn't have won. If it wasn't for Stacey Abrams, Georgia would be red, and Trump would have a second term. Is there anybody that can say if it wasn't for the women, you wouldn't have that degree? If it wasn't for the women, you wouldn't have that job. If it wasn't for the women, you wouldn't be that strong. If it wasn't for the women, you wouldn't be that mature. If it wasn't for the women, I need somebody, anybody, everybody to thank God for the hidden figures that got you here. Thank God for the women that remind you that greater is God that is in you than anything that's in the world. But I want to remind you that if God didn't do it through the women, you wouldn't be here. And somebody say, well, I don't know women that good. Well, I don't know where you've been living. But if for some reason a woman has never helped you, or for some reason you can't see a woman meeting you, I should remind you that I met God and she was black, because God is a mother to the motherless. God is a friend to the friendless. God is a way maker, a burden bearer, promise keeper. 'Cause I've seen God make a way. I've seen God open doors. I've seen God protect my future. I've seen God take care of my family. I've seen God do what no other power can do. Won't God make a way for you? Won't she open doors for you? Won't she provide for you? Won't God give you joy? Won't she give you peace? Won't she give you what you need? Shout yes, yes, yes. When I think of the goodness of God and all she's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah, I'm here. I'm here. Will you tell somebody, I'm still here. 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 If it wasn't for the women, woo, thank you, Jesus.
Greetings, New Salem family, and all our special guests. These are your top five announcements for this week. Number one, Revival Week is here. And our theme this year is Leading a Connected Life. You don't want to miss 3 nights of worship, praise, and renewal. Come join us Monday through Wednesday this week at 7 p.m. for an old-fashioned revival in a virtual environment. Your giving throughout the week will help support New Salem's 2021 through 2022 college scholarships. Number two. New Salem Church has added a new platform for Sunday virtual service called Church Online. In addition to Facebook Live and YouTube Live, Church Online allows more interaction with our prayer ministry and online host in real time. Go to newsalemcares.org/worship to register and join our service. Number three. Do you miss going to the movies with family and friends? Let's watch a movie together. Promised Land Kids, join us for March Movie Time, Saturday, March 27th at noon. Registration ends this Wednesday, March 24th. There will be a special surprise, so make sure you register today. For more information, go to the church website. Number four. Unscripted, the bi-weekly Young Adult Forum, will feature special guest speaker Tajay Beula, PhD, Assistant Professor of History, Ethics, and Black Church and African Diaspora Studies at Methodist Theological School in Ohio. Watch it live on Thursday at 6:30 p.m. on Zoom. And number five, tune in to Wellness Wednesday on Facebook Live at noon, yes, noon, next week, for a special Lunch and Learn in honor of Multiple Myeloma Awareness Month. Hear from patients, physicians, and policymakers as they share their personal stories, as well as valuable information on the disease and how it disproportionately impacts the Black community, which has 2 to 3 times higher incidence rates of multiple myeloma. Join us live on our Facebook page on March 24th at 12 o'clock noon Eastern. All of these announcements can be found on church.newsalemcares.org or in the link below. Please follow us on social media for updates and information throughout the week. These are your top five announcements. Have a wonderful week.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Pastor Willie Francois, for that powerful word to get us started for our 2021 revival. We're grateful that God has used you in a major way to set the atmosphere for the rest of this week. We also now want to make a shift and open up the doors of the church and invite anybody to become a part of the family of God. We're excited what God's going to do today and the next 3 days as we seek to get revived, rewoke, to open up, let God use us and speak to us. And so we're going to do that in the following ways. 3 ways you can become a part of the New Salem family. You can connect by sending a text to 614-568-4858 or send an email to nsprayerministry@newsalemcares.com or just visit the church at newsalem.com and connect and come on in. We are excited what's going to happen. We want God to have a major time with us this week as we seek to grow closer to Him and to you. May God bless you and may God keep you. Amen. We now want to pray ourselves for giving time here at the New Salem Church during our revival. Thank you for your good stewardship and generosity. I want to continue to move in that effort as we now begin to move towards spring and deal with the needs and concerns of the community as it begins to open up, given the vaccinations and more people getting healthier. So we want to be ready to receive them and also ready to do ministry. You can do that 5 different ways. Visit church.newsalemcares.com/give. Use the Shelby Next app or use the Cash App $NSCares. Text your amount to 614-333-0656, or you can stop by the church and give your gift at the New Salem Baptist Church at 2956 Cleveland Avenue. This week we will not give a benediction till Wednesday evening. We will be in a spirit of revival starting today, moving all the way through Wednesday. We want to encourage you to continue that spirit, but we will close with a word of prayer. God, thank you for the power of your presence and your spirit, giving us peace and understanding. Continue to bless our revivals as we seek to do what you're happy to do with the New Salem family and community. Bless you, we ask this all in your son's name. Amen.